All right, folks. So if you have written software in an industrial setting for any length of time, you have probably heard of or used the cyclomatic complexity measure. And today I want to look at the paper where it was first introduced. The author was Thomas McCabe, and this was published back in 1976. The goal of this paper is to come up with a quantitative measure or a mathematical technique that lets us get an idea of the complexity of a given program. And why do we want to do that? We want to do that to identify pieces of code that are complex and that will hence be difficult to test, difficult to maintain, and difficult to understand. A naive attempt to do so would be to limit the physical size of a program, say in number of lines of code. But it is very possible to have short pieces of code that contain a lot of complexity. The example the author uses here is a 50-line program which has 25 consecutive if statements. Such a program would have more than 33 million control paths, and only a small fraction of those would realistically ever get tested. So the next idea would be to propose a complexity measure which somehow counts the number of control paths through a program. The first hitch with this proposal is that any program with a loop has an infinite number of paths. And to get around that problem, we want to base our measure not on the total number of paths, but what the author refers to here as basic paths. These are the paths which, in combination, can yield all possible paths a program can take. This brings us to the definition of the cyclomatic number of a graph G. If you have n vertices, e edges, and p connected components, the cyclomatic number is e minus n plus p. And why are we computing this for a graph? We're doing this because we are going to model a program as a control flow graph. A control flow graph is a graph representation of a program where each node in the graph corresponds to a continuous block of code in the program where flow only enters at the top and only exits at the bottom. The edges correspond to branches taken in the program. Let's look at some common structured programming constructs along with what their cyclomatic complexity would be. If you have a simple sequence with no branching, its cyclomatic complexity is 1. It has one edge, two nodes, and one connected component. If you look at an if-then-else construct, this top node is the if condition on which you're branching. One of these is the then branch, the other one is the else branch, and this is the code following the if statement. The cyclomatic complexity of an if-then clause is 2. Similarly, this is how you model a while loop and an until loop, and the cyclomatic complexity of both of these, we see that they have three edges and three nodes. So that would be 3 minus 3 plus 2. So the cyclomatic complexity of while and until would both be 2. So with this definition and the examples, we can see that cyclomatic complexity corresponds pretty nicely to our intuitive understanding of complexity being manifested as the number of paths through a program. And I think it is partly the simplicity and this ease of understanding that has contributed to the widespread use of this metric in software engineering practice. Here are some properties of cyclomatic complexity. It is always at least one, because the simplest program, which is a straight line sequential program, has cyclomatic complexity 1. It is the maximum number of linearly independent paths in G, which is to say that It is the same as the size of a basis set of paths. And these are the basic paths using combinations of which you can construct all paths through a program. A few other interesting properties: inserting a new edge increases the complexity by one, and the complexity depends only on the decision structure of your control flow graph. The author looks at some example control flow graphs. Some of them are simple, like this one that has a cyclomatic complexity of only 3, and some of them begin to look much more complex, like this one with a complexity of 8, or this one with a complexity of 10. I would definitely not look forward to editing a method that had a structure like this. Based on his own experience, the author suggests using 10 as an upper bound for cyclomatic complexity. And you'll find this bound used in many modern programs as well that report on cyclomatic complexity within a code base. One very notable exception to this is code which uses a very large switch case statement. Such code is going to have a cyclomatic complexity that is equal to the number of cases within the switch statement. Now, this is still structured programming, and it is not necessarily very complex or hard to understand. So most modern analyzers that compute cyclomatic complexity will treat it as a special case. Now, let's look at how cyclomatic complexity behaves when a program is decomposed. And this will bring us to why we use connected components in the definition of cyclomatic complexity. If you consider a main program that calls two subroutines A and B, in this case we have 3 connected components, and the cyclomatic complexity of the entire program is 6. We note that cyclomatic complexity is linear over addition, in that the complexity of 3 components is the sum of the complexity of the individual components by themselves. And this is fairly easy to prove if you simply expand out the definition. We can derive some handy shortcuts. If we have a program where the number of functions, predicates, and collecting nodes is theta, pi, and gamma, respectively, we end up with this neat formula which says that its cyclomatic complexity is pi plus 1, which is simply 1 more than the number of predicates in the function. Here, the author makes an important clarification, which is that if an if statement uses 2 predicates within its condition, we should count that as adding 2 to the cyclomatic complexity, not just adding 1. And the reason is that each of those predicates adds a decision point by itself. Now we come to a very striking and beautiful relationship between cyclomatic complexity and Euler's theorem for graphs. If G is a connected planar graph with n vertices, e edges, and r regions, then Euler's theorem states that n minus e plus r equals true. What is a planar graph? A planar graph is simply a graph that can be drawn on a two-dimensional surface or a plane without its edges intersecting. And what are regions? Regions are the number of, well, regions that the graph breaks the plane into. And if we rearrange this formula, we see that the number of regions is exactly the same as the cyclomatic complexity of a graph. It also intuitively corresponds to a notion of complexity where the more edges and nodes you have in a graph, the more regions it breaks the plane into on which you're drawing it, and the more complexity it has. Next, the author looks at the relationship between cyclomatic complexity and unstructured programming. He makes the really interesting observation that only 4 control structures are able to generate all unstructured programs, and it is these four graphs. Now, by the looks of it, you can't tell what exactly is happening here, but these correspond to four very common unstructured patterns. So the first one, this is branching out of a loop. This one is branching into a loop. This is branching into a decision. And this is branching out of a decision. And if you take the contrapositive of that, you arrive at the conclusion that you can write a structured program by simply not branching in or out of a loop or in or out of a decision. Now, here's the somewhat surprising result, which states that an unstructured program cannot be just a little bit unstructured, which is to say that it must contain at least two of those four basic unstructured graphs. You cannot have an unstructured program which contains only one of them. And you can prove that by going on a case-by-case basis through each of those graphs. To take just one example, this graph is branching into a loop. And then the question becomes, where does this node E come from? And if you run through all the cases of where it might come from, you will reach the conclusion that there must be at least two unstructured constructs within this program. We can also prove that a structured program is reducible to one that has complexity of exactly one. What is the definition of reducibility? If we take subgraphs within a graph that have only one entry and exit node and remove it and replace it by a single node, we can say that the second graph is a reduction of the first one. In other words, reduction is the process of removing subgraphs with unique entry and exit nodes. And in this example, you can see how a structured program can be reduced step by step into a linear program which has a cyclomatic complexity of one. And all this brings us back to testing, which was one of the initial motivations for proposing this cyclomatic complexity measure in the first place. Suppose you have a program P with cyclomatic complexity V, and the number of paths tested is AC, which the author refers to as its actual complexity. Now, if AC is less than V, what does that mean? That means you definitely have some more testing to do. That means you definitely have some more testing to do because not all paths have been tested. Or you can reduce the complexity of your program by reducing some of the decisions in it. Or you can simplify the code to be more linear. And this is where cyclomatic complexity can be used as a helpful guide in testing, because when the actual number of paths tested is compared against the cyclomatic complexity, one can usually discover paths that have not been tested. So that was a look at McCabe's original paper that proposed cyclomatic complexity. I'll just end with a couple of quick thoughts on how I have seen it used in practice. Now, this measure has been critiqued a lot in software engineering academia, but it still continues to be used heavily in industry. Like I mentioned earlier, I think one of the main reasons for that is the simplicity and intuitive sense that this definition makes. Another critique often leveled at cyclomatic complexity is that if you take one program and break it into distinct functions or methods, that will actually increase your cyclomatic complexity because of the 2P term in the formula. And that is often the reason that in industry, you see cyclomatic complexity usually being used only at the level of a method or a function, not at a whole program level. This is not an absolute measure. It's merely a helpful guide. It should be used with other measures, other metrics, and most of all, your judgment in deciding what parts of your program are messy or complicated. I hope you enjoyed that, and I will see you next time. Thank you very much.